Hello everyone. In this video, we are going to look at 15 points to look for in a stock before buying it. So before we decide to buy a stock for long term, so we should look for some important points that should be present in that company of which stock you are buying. Then only you should go and buy it. So if you are buying it for long term, 10 years, 15 years. And also, and my viewpoint is that you should not consider all these 15 points like equally important, but you should always give some, I will say, importance to all these points. Not equal importance, but some importance to all these points. So if a stock takes on all these 15, points, I think it should be considered very ideal to invest in that stock. And if let's some stock takes only 10 points, I'm not saying you should not invest in that stock, but look at what are the 5 points at which it is failing. Are those 5 points very important? So think about that. And so I've already made some videos on basics of a stock market and basics of mutual fund. So if you're interested to watch that, I mean, do see those videos on my channel. Plus, do not forget to subscribe to my channel for, I mean, a lot of videos like this where I'm discussing about when to buy a stock, when to sell a stock. And these all videos are for long term, not for short term. So let's start from the first point that I have here. And also I will share this PPT. This PPT's link should be there. You can see that in description or in the comments in this video. Now, I have discussed about this approach, that is invest in what you know approach. So this is like investing in only companies whose products you are knowing or you are using. So take example of HUL, Hindustan Unilever Limited. So HUL has products like Lux, it has Surf Excel, Rin, Vim, many other products like this. But we do use all these products in our day-to-day life. Similarly, I will take another example of Royal Enfield. So Royal Enfield bikes, it is sold by a company called Eicher Motors. So these all are products that we use in our day-to-day life. So my approach is something, okay, first I've tried to find out stocks which I use, I mean whose products I use in day-to-day life. Then I will run these 15 filters through it and then we'll see, okay, which stocks are basically ticking on most of this. I will tell you also which are the very important points in that. Some of them are not very important, some of them are very important. So I will tell them when I'm going through that. So with other companies, let's say if you do not understand some sector, then if that sector is going to boom in future and if you want to invest, it's better to study that sector, understand about the company, understand the risks about that company, then only invest in that. Take example of like banks, insurance, pharma, chemicals, IT industry, right? Maybe you will not have a lot of knowledge about these sectors. Okay, banks you use in day-to-day life, but you do not know how bank works like. Insurance you do not know. Pharma is also very tough to understand. Chemicals and IT are similar. Because these are not consumer facing business. I understand banks are insurance, pharma, everything, you are buying it, but it's not consumer facing like maybe HUL or I mean, HUL products like Vim, Surf Excel are using every day. Sometimes when you have some, any medicines, you do not know which company is even making that. Similarly for chemicals, chemicals are normally included in your products like soaps and everything, you do not know much about that. And the known companies will be like FMCG companies, cars companies you know, bikes you will know, many electronic items company you will know. Similarly, paints, Asian Paints you will be using, so these all you will know. And the first thing you have to do is that build a story of the company in your mind. So let's say you have identified that, okay, this company products I know and the products of that company, I will say, has a lot of demand in the market, everybody is using it. So, okay, now you have picked up 30, 40 stocks like this. Now let's try to build some story about that and how that company will do in future, like whether demand will increase for its products, whether it will decrease. Since the products are consumer facing, you can take a guess at that, right? So that let's try to build a story first. Let's do the next one. Now I will go through the 15 points here, which are very important. And I have taken most of these points from books of like Common Stock and Uncommon Profits and also many of the Peter Lynch books that I have read. These points mostly are from Common Stocks and Uncommon Profits book. The first one is that, does the company have products or services with sufficient market potential to make a possible sizable increase in sales for at least several years? That simply means that company you want to invest in, can the sales for that company keep increasing over year by year for long term, for 10 years, 15 years? Can it happen? And also, does that company have that products whose sales can increase? So that the first one is, can the company keep on increasing sales year by year? So you need a growth, right? If you want to like make more profit, the sales should increase. Now, first you should take a dig at in which sector actually the company is operating, whether it is declining or saturated, or it is like a very high demanding market. So take example of oil market or razor market, television market. So this market, if you see, are either saturated or are declining now. We have electric vehicles now. Razor also, not a lot of people are saving frequently nowadays. Television also, I will say it's kind of so saturated because most people have laptop and everybody using online like Netflix and everything to watch movies and other stuffs. Now, what about this? So are these companies trying to enter emerging markets to increase sales? Okay, these sales are saturated for these products. Are this company entering some other market whether they can increase the sales? Because the aim is to increase the sales, either through the whatever product they are selling now, or either through some new products. Let's see, sectors whose products demand is increasing, like electric vehicles, healthy drinks. So people are moving away from, like, you say, cold drinks like Coca-Cola and Pepsi. They're moving to healthy drinks now. Insurance, like penetration level in India is very low, so the demand for insurance is increasing. Some examples in Indian context will be Titan. So Titan has this brand Tanishq, and Tanishq in jewelry sector, and it has only 5% market share in organized jewelry. So it has a lot of, I will say, market to capture. And Tanishq products are known, I mean, most of, like, I will say, our family or many of your family would be shopping with Tanishq. So if you see great demand that, okay, the demand for gold and jewelry will keep going up, then I will say Titan is a good, that fits in that. Its sales can keep on increasing. And it has increased actually, 10 to 15, it has increased of 15% sales in last 10 years. HDFC is another in housing loans. Number of houses, I mean, is increasing, I mean, year by year. And housing loans demand is also increasing. HDFC leader in that. Another is HDFC Bank, Kotak Mahindra Bank. These are private banks and they are taking market share away from many public sector banks. That's how they are increasing their sales. Avenue Supermarts, which runs DMart chain of stores. It's in organ See, organized retail is only 15% of overall retail market in India. That means 85% is, I mean, that is online or unorganized retail. So Avenue Supermarts or DMart has a lot of market to capture. So look at long-term growth stories where the sales can grow like 10% or 15% for 10 years, 15 years, these type of companies. Second point is, does the management have a determination to continue to develop products or processes that will still further increase total sales potentials when the growth potentials of currently attractive product lines have largely been exploited? That means that, okay, the company was selling something, some products, but now sales of that product has almost, let's say, saturated or declining. Now the company has this ability to maybe launch some new products or some products whose demand is increasing. Does the management has this ability? So in this, you can look at normally how much company investing in research and development. So if a company is investing in research and development a lot, they will be like maybe making a lot of new products in the future. Take example, I will say Reliance Industries, which are in investment phase for a long period of time, when the stock price of it was like flat, and it has now converted from oil company to almost technology or retail company through Jio and Reliance Retail. Similarly, ITC was cigarettes company, and if you see the sales for cigarette is almost flat. So now they are into FMCG and they are expanding their sales into FMCG. Britannia, it was a biscuits company, and the sales here, I will say, it's kind of saturated, not very high growth area, and now they're expanding into other food categories like milk products, breads, other stuff. Titan, I will say, is another classical example of this. They were into watches first. I mean, you'll be knowing Titan through watches, but they are now into eyeglasses, eyewears, as well as Tanishq jewelry. And this Tanishq contributes almost like 80 to 85% of the revenues today. HDFC. So they were in housing loans first. Now they are in banking, they are in insurance, they are in asset management, they are everywhere now. So look into this type of companies. If the sales of some, I mean, the existing products are saturated, are they trying to enter some new ones? Now, how effective are the companies? I will say the first two points are very important because sales is very important, I will say, for any company if you're looking for long-term investment. How effective are the company research and development efforts in relation to its size? So look at the revenue of that company and see how much, as percentage of revenue, how much the company is investing into R&D, research and development. Now, not all the sectors require heavy spend on R&D, because if you see retail sector and other sectors like this, they don't require much investment in this. But take example IT, pharma, chemicals, automobile sector, this requires a lot of effort in for research and development, because they have to keep on innovating some new products. Like for automobile sector, now, I mean, the transition is happening to electric vehicles, so they have to develop new technology. IT, of course, I mean, if you look at Amazon and Microsoft, they have to keep on developing new products. Similarly for IT sector also, service-based companies like TCS and all, they have to keep on, I mean, I will say adjusting. Like if you have machine learning today, they have to shift to machine learning. They have to invest in that, because that is the, I will say, maybe the demand for machine learning products are going to increase in the future. So they have to keep investing in that. Similar for pharma and chemicals, if they have to come up with new products. And also compare within the same sector, how much percentage this is. No, do not compare, I mean, IT with pharma sector. That's not good. I mean, that's not equal, right? Both sectors are different. So you should compare within a sector. And from one of the survey I found out at Tata Motors, it figures at 99. So in the top 100 countries in R&D, Tata Motors was at 99th position globally, because it is investing a lot in, I will say, Jaguar and Land Rover, like transition from, I will say, diesel to electric vehicles because of that. Okay, and that's why if you see, if it includes JLR, the rank is impressive 13. Sun Pharma is like 104 rank. Mahindra is 114. Lupin is 120. Dr. Reddy 120. These are all pharma, IT, or you will see automobiles company. So this is the rank, global rank. I have given this list from that link. It's here. I have given this list here. What is the R&D spend as a percentage of revenues? So this is important for this type of sectors to look out, like who are investing more, because the, I mean, that these sectors keep on changing. Chemicals keep on changing. I will say new chemicals, I mean, comes in the market. Similarly, IT also keeps on changing. These are like very, I will say, very fast moving sectors. So you should keep a note of this. This you will normally see in the annual reports of the company. They will mention this. Now, how the sales or net profits has been contributed to a company by the results of a research organization during a particular span, such as 10 years. Actually, these numbers are not very easy to calculate, not very easy to determine, like how much R&D is helping in profits and sales. But still, as a percentage of sales, if you're looking at R&D, and if it is high, that means company is investing a lot, that means. And it may launch new products. Like company like Apple, they have been very innovative in this, and they spend a large chunk of their, I will say, profits or their money on R&D. Most tech companies do that. Now, this is, I will not say very important, but this is important for consumer-facing companies. Does the company have an above-average sales organization? So, okay, sale is like the most basic single activity of a business. So, if a sale is not done, there is no profit. There is nothing, right? I mean, sale of the product should be done first, ideally. Now, you should look at how much the company is spending on advertising as percentage of its revenue. Also, you can look at, for the FMCG company, look at distribution reach of the company. Like HUL, ITC will have like a very, I will say, it has like a lot of distribution points. It can reach every nook and corner, I will say, of India, its product. So look at that also. I mean, it does not make sense if you are making good products, but your products itself are not available in the market wherever you go. And this has been situation, this has been happening for many companies. If you, for, I mean, I have seen for Godrej Consumer Products, they have a lot of products. Some of them are not even available in the, I mean, the market I go for buying stuffs. Now, this company like HUL, Reliance, Maruti Suzuki, Procter and Gamble, ITC, these are all are FMCG companies, consumer-facing companies. They do a lot of advertisement, and they spend a lot of like money on this. Like HUL spends about 3,500 crore on advertising and accounts for roughly 15% of spends and 20% of countries' ads on TV. That's huge, right? HUL is known for advertising. Their products like has a lot of demand now, and this advertising, I will say, has played a equally important part in that. You have seen many ads of HUL, Taj. I mean, what was that? Taj Mahal. I mean, that was tea, right? There was an ad for this. They have good ad for, I mean, Lux and other products. And also, I have read this book actually, The CEO Factory, and that in that it has been mentioned how HUL has like increased its sale with the help of advertising. So it's very important that those consumer-facing companies are also spending good on advertising, so that people are knowing that, okay, these products at least exist. And ITC now is very, I will say, I mean, it is very, what I will say, it is also, I mean, aggressively advertising its products now in FMCG, so that the products are known. And okay, this is the last point is mostly important for consumer-facing companies. Now, this is what does the companies, this is the fifth point, does the company have worthwhile profit margin? So I will say this is also a very important point. Now, companies having higher profit margins normally has motor monopoly. This is why, this is because, let's say if the company has a margin of 20-25%, and if does not have monopoly, then or some, let's say, entry to, sorry, barriers to entry, then some other companies can also make similar type of products and enter that with low pricing. Now, this company whose profit margin was 20+%, now it has to decrease the price, right? And then I will say the margin contraction will happen. Mostly, you will see if the company has 20%, I will say, profit margins, it must be having a moat or it must be a monopoly. I'll just give some examples. Take example of cigarettes business of ITC. It has a very good profit margin, I mean. And it's almost monopoly, 80%, 85% market share. Eicher Motors, it has like 20%, more than 20% profit, I mean, operating, sorry, profit margins. And this is operating profit margin. There are a lot of other margins also. This is like whatever sales you do and revenues you do, and this percentage, whatever you get, right? You divide the sales by this and you get the percentage there. Eicher Motor, Royal Enfield, Nestle India through Maggi, it has monopoly. Page Industries through Jockey. And ideally, I want a company with greater than 15% operating margin at least. Now, what happens if the company has very thin margin, like 8%, 7%, 10%? Now, if it has very less margin, plus let's say some bad times happen, like let's say they are also high on debt. Now, the issue can happen. Since the margin they have very less, their margin can also decrease. Their debt is also there. So they may go bankrupt also in that case. So it's better to have like higher profit margin. Plus, in some cases, this is exception case also exists. Take example of small companies which are trying to expand. So they may be having low margins now, but since they are expanding now, they may, because they, I mean, they have a lot of opportunities in that sector, like Mahindra Logistics in the logistics sector. And logistics sector is booming now. And Mahindra Logistics has a lot, has like 4-5%, I will say, profit margins, operating margin. That's very less. But here, the opportunity size is very high for this. And company is still, I will say, in very small, its company is very small now. So it has a lot of opportunity to, I mean, I will say, increase its sales and also increase margin in the future. Next one is, what is the company doing to maintain or improve profit margins? This is also very important. Okay, the company has 15%, but will this 15% margin sustain in the future? What is the company doing for this? Or is the company trying to increase the margins? Then what is the company doing? Because see, labor cost and raw material cost are increasing year by year, right? So inflation is increasing, the labor costs are increasing. So one way of, I will say, increasing the operating margin is like if you increase the price of your products, that way you can increase. But it's not sustainable for how much long term you will keep on increasing prices. So you will see most good companies, they do not follow this approach of rising prices of products. They may do it temporarily for some time, but over a long period of time, no, they will not follow this. They will try like cost cutting approaches, like maybe there are some work that is being done manually. They may take help of some machine to do it. They may maybe outsource the manufacturing. I mean, this is a cost cutting they can do. They will do it mostly in future. Or design new equipments that are very efficient to reduce cost. This can also happen. In this case, you should look at return on capital employed. That is very important. What if they are able to maybe sustain a, I will say, good, let's say, amount of return on capital employed, because that gives a, I will say, indicator of profitability. We will see that in next slide. HUL has like a ROC of more than 100%. In this, actually, this what is the company doing? In this one example, I wanted to give of Britannia Industries under Varun Berry. When Varun Berry came in, he came in around 2013. He joined as CEO 2013 of Britannia Industries. And if you see the operating margin here, you can see it, right? It was 7% in March 2013, and it has increased to 16% now, right? So what he has tried to do is he has tried to cut down the expenses or cut down the cost of the raw materials, and that's how he has been able to increase the margin to 16.7%. And similarly, you can see the ROC growth also from 22% it was 2011, 39 in 2013, and almost it has touched 68% in 16, and now again it has decreased. So he has done a very good job in this. Next one is how efficiently the company is able to deploy its capital. This is very important, I will say, ROC, return on capital employed. So some of the important things to look in company are sales, increasing sales. I will say, what are the margins of the company, operating margins of the company. Now this one is another important, how efficiently the company is able to deploy its capital. That is high ROC or how high ROE. I will say the difference between these two. Now think about this. This is return on capital employed. Let's say you are also investing, let's say, some money in FD. Now that is you're employing the capital in FD. Now that FD is fixed deposit is giving you 7% return. Now you are even able to get 7% return from this very safe instruments like fixed deposits. Now if a company is only giving you a return on capital employed of 8%, why you should invest in that company? You can, I mean, that company can do a FD for that money, whatever capital is there, and the company will get 8% on that. Why to basically run the company, right? If it is giving 7-8%. So, I mean, you can also do the same, right? You can basically you are and they are employing the capital, right? You can also employ your capital, get 7-8%. Now, typically it should be like this ROC should be double than the current interest rates. So I will say ideally around 15%. Also, do not get confused. For financial companies, look at ROE, return on equity. See, return on capital employed is equity capital plus the debt capital, or the company would have taken loans from bank to build some new buildings or infrastructure, right? So ROC includes both equity plus this debt, but ROE only includes equity. Or think of banks. Banks work on how does bank work? Bank will first take loans from, not loans exactly, but they will take FDs, right? Fixed deposits from customers. They will have savings account, everything. Plus, banks will also raise money from the market. And through this money, they will sell loans, right, to other persons. So that's how these banks make money on difference of this amount. Now, for banks, it does not make sense to go for this return on capital employed much, because it is better, I mean, return on capital employed also includes this debt that they have taken. But this debt is not bad for them, because they're making money through this debt, right? This is different from what other companies do with debt. Other companies build infrastructure, machines, they buy machines, everything. Banks do not do this. Banks take this money from customers, then they provide this money to other customers as loans and other products. And the difference here, like they have raised money at 5% and they are giving loan at 10%, the difference that is making is their profit. Also, asset-light business have higher ROCE or ROE because the capital is less, and also this capital is not increasing a lot because they do not have to like maybe do a lot of CapEx, that is capacity utilization, create more buildings, create more factories. They do not have to do this because they have outsourced their manufacturing through some other companies. And this is also a very good measure of profitability, because ROCE is what? You divide the, I will say, earnings before interest and tax by the total capital. ROE is similar, net income by equity capital. So you see that numerator in both sides is your profit. So that's why it's a good measure of profitability also. Now, in some cases, in most cases, you will see ROCE is greater than ROE, and there is reason for this. Like if you see ROCE definition, that is earnings before interest and tax divided by capital employed. Capital employed is both equity plus debt. ROE is net profit by shareholders' equity. Now, let's say if a company has zero debt, For that, the denominator in both cases will be same because the company doesn't have any debt, so it has only shareholders' equity. Now, in first case, if you see, it's earning before interest and tax. Now, this will be higher, right? Because tax has not. See, okay, I understand interest. It has. It, the company has not. Company will not be paying any interest because it doesn't have loan, but it will have tax to pay. But in this ROE, the calculation is after tax. That is, net profit is after tax. So of course, it will be lower, right? Your ROE will be lower because tax is also 30%, 25%, right? So net profit is, of course, I told you, right? I mean, is normally lesser than earning before interest and tax. Now take your HUL. ROC is 116%, ROE is 82% because tax is 30% here. Also, if a company is sitting with a lot of cash and if they decide to maybe see what can happen is sub company in their calculation of ROC, if they are not including, so in ROC they are including both, let's say the cash sitting on the books, but this cash is not actually being deployed. But if they are using this, in that case ROC may be higher because ROE that will not be used, that is shareholders' equity is only used. Now this is the ITC ROC below. If you see, it's been like 50%, 51%, right? Now it's decreasing. So why is it decreasing now? Because they are investing now in creating a lot of factories, other factories, and I will say food parks, everything. But the results of this, like the profits from this, is not being sown now. It will take some time to sow these profits because this is in, they are in investment phase now. That's why it's decreasing a bit. So mostly with FMCG IT companies, you will see a ROC being lot higher because see IT company also, they only work with employees. They do not have to create a lot of factory and everything. They just have offices and employees, nothing much, laptops and other stuffs. So Page Industries, the company that makes Jockey, has 65% ROC. Nestle India has 70%. Tata Elxsi IT company has 50%. TCS, another IT company, 47%. Britannia, another FMCG company with 44% ROC. So these are very good companies in ROC. But you should not look at only one parameter, ROC. So look at other things also, sales and other stuffs also. Now the next is regarding the management. Does the company have outstanding labor and personal relations? Does the company have outstanding executive relations? Does the company have debt to its management? So these are related to management of the company and the relationship between the management and the employees and the executives. So how are the employees treated by the company? You can look at the Glassdoor rating for this. I will give an example because at Glassdoor you will see that the employees have given rating. How was their experience at the company or how is their experience at this company? They normally give a rating and the feedback about the company. So you can look at that. Or are workers fired in large masses? So is this happening that company? This may be sometimes negative point about the management. Now also look at salaries of the executives, that is top management. Are these in line with the industry? In that, I mean, compare with the other sector companies and see what is the salary for others. Also, whether the management is very professional or not. So normally, I prefer to invest in, I will say, management who are very professional or who have been known to be very professional. I will say like very ethical companies. Like I will say, HDFC is one of them. It's a no. I mean, it's pro management is known to everyone. Then I will say Tata companies. On some other company, I mean, mostly this type of companies. Also, what if the key man is no longer available? And also, other examples could be Bajaj, Godrej. These are all, I mean, these all management are well known, and these are very old management, like 30, 30, 45 years. And also, what if the key man is no longer available? So I told you this point, right? Does the company have debt to its management? So if it has debt to its management, maybe it can happen. They will be investing in training their employees for executive roles in future. That is good point. If the management is from, let's say, somebody got hired as, let's say, I will say, at very low position, and he went higher and higher and became, let's say, CEO of the company, it's quite good because that CEO will know a lot about that company, and versus somebody from outside coming to the company as CEO. So I told you Glassdoor rating. So I gave an example, Tata Chemicals and Marico. Tata Chemicals 4.1 out of 5, I think is very good. Marico another 4.0, it's quite good. So you should always look at the recent reviews, like last 2 years, and you can also go to Glassdoor and look at that. So I normally try to maybe look at least 3.5 plus ratings should be there at Glassdoor, and the number of reviews should also be like high. It should not be like, okay, there are only 10 reviews or 15 reviews. It should be like, okay, at least 100 reviews at least. एंड इंडस्ट्री इज लाइक इज द कंपनी कैपेक्स से भी. सो लेट मी मेक यू अंडरस्टैंड वाट इज कैपेक्स. कैपेक्स इज कैपिटल एक्सपेंडिचर और कैपिटल एक्सपेंस इज द मनी एन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन और कॉर्पोरेट एंटिटी स्पेंड्स टू बाई मेंटेन और इम्प्रूव इट्स फिक्स एसेट्स सच एज बिल्डिंग्स व्हीकल्स इक्विपमेंट्स और लैंड. दिस इज नॉर्मली इफ ए कंपनी वॉन्ट्स टू एक्सपैंड इट विल बी मे बी क्रिएटिंग ए न्यू फैक्ट्री. सो दीज आर पार्ट ऑफ कैपेक्स. द कैपेक्स इज नॉर्मली हाई फॉर दिस टाइप ऑफ कंपनीज लाइक एनर्जी कंपनीज, ऑयल गैस, कोल प्रोड्यूसर इज अर कंपनीज, ट्रांसपोर्टेशन, एयरलाइंस, रेलवेज. अनदर कुड बी टेलीकॉम एंड इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर. सो इन टेलीकॉम आई मीन ए लॉट ऑफ आई विल से यू हैव लाइक आई मीन यू हैव टू कनेक्ट ऑल दिस प्लेसेज राइट थ्रू वायर्स और समथिंग एवरीथिंग. सो इट रिक्वायर्स लॉट ऑफ इन्वेस्टमेंट, टावर्स यू नीड. These are some of the, I will say, capex heavy companies. So I normally avoid in most of this. Telecom may be exceptional case for me because telecom is something like, okay, once you have done the investment, maybe then you can reap the profits like Reliance is doing now. But yeah, again, you have to also be ready for the future. Like if 5G happens, like your towers and everything should be ready for that future. And that's what Reliance has told, that it will not be doing a lot of investment if it has to upgrade to 5G. So that's good. It will not be doing a lot of investment for 5G. So look for companies having higher free cash flow. So what is free cash flow? So this will normally be in the cash flow section of the report, annual report. So free cash flow is like operating cash. What is the cash the company has made minus capex? So whatever this, I mean, the money is spent on this factories and all. For growth companies may have higher capex. This may can happen because growth companies will be expanding a lot, so they will be creating a lot of offices, a lot of factories, everything. So initially their capex will be high. Take example of Avenue Supermarts or new banks. So Avenue Supermarts is expanding a lot, so it spends most of its profits on doing capex, on opening new stores. Similarly, new banks will be spending a lot of money on opening new branches. So negative, so okay, positive cash flow is very good. But what if the cash flow is negative? So negative cash flow, I will say, is bad, but not always bad. But because negative cash flow can happen for Avenue Supermarts or new banks, right? Because they are in investing phase. But also look at what is the return on capital employed. So they are employing this capital in opening new stores and everything. Now look at what returns they are making through this. So Avenue Supermarts does have a good return on capital employed. So that's good. When they are building new retail stores, they are also getting a very good return on that. So that's very good. So also look at this. Now this is also very important. How much debt the company is using to finance its business? I will say this is very important because let's look at this. Normally, typically I look at debt to equity ratio because see the equity part, why are we looking at this? Because see equity part, with the help of equity, you would have created a lot of assets, right? So we look at debt to, I will say, equity ratio because equity is almost like almost your all your assets. Then, and these assets are not financed through debt. That's why I will include equity here. That's really lesser than 0.5. For mostly for me, I look at 0.5. It's like greater than this, then okay, maybe for me, I will mostly try to avoid those companies. This is not applicable to financial companies. As I told you, financial companies works on this model because they take loan for their working requirement itself. So it's not applicable. Their debt to equity will be 5, 3, 4. Then you should, it's not a negative flag for them. Now, high debt can make a company bankrupt. So see what can happen if a company has high debt and bad times happens for that sector or that company can bankrupt. Like take example, Kingfisher or Jet Airways. They both were on very high debt, and when the, I will say, oil prices happened to climb, and they were not able to even pay the salary of employees, and they went bankrupt almost. Also prefer less capital intensive companies or companies that can fund their capital requirements from their profits. That is also a very good point. Prefer companies that can fund their requirements. Okay, they are heavy, they have heavy capex, but what if they can fund their from profit itself, like DMart is doing, then it's good. Then how much of the company's profits is actually converted to cash? Actually, this is very important. We look at the balance, I will say the profit and loss statement. Okay, profit is increased 20% every year by year. But we typically do not look at what is the cash actually that is being generated by a company. It can happen. Company profits are increasing at 20% per year. Its cash is only increasing at 5% per year. That can also happen. I will show you how it can happen. So look at the cash flow statement, cash from operating activities. How many cash the company is making by its operation, that is selling their products. Now, profits from operation minus tax should be close to this cash earning, that is operating this thing, because profits from operation you have to subtract from tax. Then you will be left from whatever profit that has made, and this profit should be ideally equal to, mostly will not be equal to, but it should be close to the, I will say, the cash that company has. I will give you an example. See, many companies, what they will do is they may sell the products on, I will say, credit card or other stuff. I mean, mostly on credit. Now they will not be getting, I mean, some customers, it may happen, if bad times happen, many customers will not pay them, right? In that case, what happens? They will not receive the amount. So in some other quarter, they will show you that, okay, they didn't receive, and they will, basically, you will see that in cash flow statement, basically. The bad signs here are increase in receivables. So these receivables are basically this thing, the credit. So somebody has taken some product on credit, and this is increasing. The number of consumer buying on credit is increasing year by year. Then that's a bad sign. That means they are not paying. Increasing inventory without increasing sales. So increasing inventory is basically, maybe some company is selling bikes. Now inventory is basically raw materials plus these bikes and everything that they are manufacturing. Now if their products are not selling and they have a lot of inventory remaining, so this may also be a bad sign, because they have already invested on this buying materials, they have paid for this, they have created this bike also, but it has not been sold in that year. That may say that, okay, the demand is not there for that product. That can also happen. Now debtor days and inventory turnover is two another things to look at. And also compare it with the peers in the same industry. Do not compare this with the, I will say, this increase in receivables, increase in inventory, right? So compare with the same industry, not with other industry. Debtor is how quickly a business gets paid, like when they sell the product, how quickly they are getting paid, in 7 days, 10 days. Lesser the debtor days, better. Inventory turnover is like how quickly an inventory gets sold. That means they have made the product, they have made the buy. Now, how fast is it getting sold? In 7 days, 14 days? Again, lesser the inventory turnover, it's better. Now, coming to last 2 points. Does the company have a management of unquestionable integrity? Now, actually, the points about management is very important, because I prefer first to go with the management. The management, I will say, is not good, I will not prefer the company itself. Because even the profits are increasing, you do not know whether the, I will say, management is, I will say, ethical or not. They are just showing the wrong profits or wrong sales, maybe it can happen. So it's best to first go through this point. The 14th point is very important. That does a company has a management of unquestionable integrity, where they are very truth to their shareholders, whatever they are speaking. You know, they are lying to their shareholders. It may happen. Many companies have done this. Does the management in control benefit themselves? Does decision against minority shareholders? So it can happen. The company may benefit themselves in many ways. Like I will say, I mean, there have been cases when mergers and everything happens. Many companies have, I will say, they have like rules and everything against the minority shareholders, where the minority shareholders, I will say, have not received the benefit. That has happened with many companies. Like I will say, Aditya Birla Group companies, I have read about them. Vedanta is another one, I will say, which has been like, lot against minority shareholders. So like Vedanta, like it was like the price was 200 sometimes back, and now they are trying to delist on price of some 80-87, right? And I mean, this is considered the fair value of that, right? What their company is fair valued at that price they stood, right? Now they are taking advantage of this COVID-19, where their price have like gone to 87-89 from 200, and now they are trying to delist it. So I will say this is very against minority shareholders who have brought this shares at 150, 200. Also look at related party transactions between management people. So this will be there in the annual reports. Like if there is like, it can happen, right? Let's say if I am the management team and I have, let's say, a house to rent, then I will ask, let's say, CEO of this company or other management, okay, can you rent this house to the company at very high yield, let's say 12%, 15%. This can happen. They can try, take advantage through company. So look at that also. Also look at salaries of people in management role and compare with their peers, whether they are also paying same. And also one easy way to search for company name plus fraud on Google. And if you find any results on that on top, I will say do not invest in that company if you find that. Of course, read that, what is the fraud, but typically avoid in this investing in these companies. Okay, after going 15 points, this 15 point, okay, 14 point, this 15 point, I will say is very important. I will say it's very important. It's a lot of it's this, I mean, the valuation of the company. It's a very controversial point also, I will say, because people keep on arguing on this a lot, whether this is overvalued, this is undervalued. Now my investing approach is something like this. You have to look at the 14 points now. Now, if your company ticks on 14 points, and most important of those are whether the company can increase the sales, does the company has a very good management, does the company has, I will say, good operating margins, does the company has very good ROCE, 15% or 20%. If the company has ticked on all this, most of this, and yeah, if the company is capex heavy or not, does the company has very high debt, all these important points the company has ticked, then okay, then look at this. I will say at last, now you have gone through the 14 and you have ticked on most important points. Now look at the last one. This is the company undervalued or overvalued, or should you buy it or not? So my approach is something like this. As I told, this is a very debatable financial parameter, and note that the company you are looking at ticks at other points. Now I typically look at, I will say, price to growth ratio. This is okay, this I have learned from Peter Lynch in his books. He also followed this approach. There are many others also. See, I have already looked at many other parameters. I told you, I have looked at cash flow, I have looked at debt, I have looked at sales, I have looked at operating margin, I have looked at everything. Now everything is like very good, then the company is like very good, I know. Now my only point is that, is the company overvalued or undervalued? If it is overvalued, should I invest in that? That's my only point. Now, since I am looking at mostly growth companies, so I told you first point, the company should be able to like capture a lot of market. I mean, it has a lot of market to capture. It should not be like the sector in which the company operates is saturated. I will not invest in those type of companies. Only the companies whose sale can keep on increasing year by year, and they have products for that. In that company only I will invest. So price to earning ratio I look at first, and it does not make sense for small companies that are very growing very fast. Price to earning does not make sense, because see, price to earning ratio is price by the earnings of per share. Now if the company earnings is increasing very, like let's say 50%, 60% year by year, typically when they are very small, that it may happen. Now PE does not make sense, because PE will keep on fluctuating. Today it is say 70, since they are growing so fast, in 2 years you will see, I mean, it's 30, right? At the same profits. So it doesn't make sense. Also, do peer comparison in that. Do not look at PE of, okay, compare one PE, like comparing automobile sectors, I mean, PE with FMCG PE doesn't make much sense. Compare PE of one automobile company to another automobile company. Okay, but I look at PEG ratio. That is, of course, related to PE ratio. So PE ratio divided by earnings growth. Because I am interested in companies whose earnings can grow a lot. If the company, I told you, if the company's earning can grow, I'm looking for 10 years. If it can grow for 20% for 10 years, then PE, I will say, I will be basically PEG ratio less than equal to 2. So I will pay for, like, if, let's say if the earning growth of the company is 30% and PE ratio is 60, then I will surely invest in that. But for that, I should look at whether the company should be able to increase the 30% or not. Does the company have that potential, that market to capture? Every supermarket, take example, is growing at 40% from last 5 years, its profits. And PE is 110. So PEG is almost 3. Now you have to decide whether you want to take the risk or not, right? Because PEG is 3 here. But if you think that 40% growth is acceptable over 10, 15 years, then I may invest in that. Titan Tech example, growing at 17% last 10 years. PE is 52. So if you see PEG, it is close to 3 again, almost, right? 17 to 34, you're close to 3. And also, a bank's financial is also important. Look at price to book ratio, because for banks, it's their book value, right? What deposits they have, everything, right? That's of more importance to them. So look at price to book value for them. Yeah, so I think this was all. So I hope you'd have got like 15 points overview what there, and I normally use most of these points. And I will again say that my important points are like, the company should be in sector in that in which it can increase sales, either by capturing market share from other companies like private banks are doing, like HDFC, Kotak Mahindra, or growing like insurance sector. It can grow, right? Because the penetration is very low. So this is a sector. Other point is that I will say operating margin is important, ROC is important, debt should be low is important. The most important point is the management. I only prefer to invest in this type of companies, I will say HDFC type of companies, Godrej companies, I will say. Another can be like, I will say, Bajaj group of companies, mostly these type of companies, and very large companies who have monopolies and which are from long time, like Asian Paints, Pidilite. Like these also companies have very good management. Plus they have very good products also. So these type of companies I normally invest in, big companies, normally which are part of Nifty 50 mostly. Britannia, ITC, I will say, Godrej Consumer Products, HDFC, HDFC Bank, Kotak Mahindra Bank, Tata Group companies, Tata Chemicals, Tata Electric, Titan. These are companies normally I'm interested in mostly. And if I want to take risk with some other companies, I will normally allocate very small, I will say, part of my portfolio to that. Okay, if I see that that company is very good and it is, I mean, the products that the company makes has a lot of demand, I will invest in that. But first I will look at the management. I will look at the CEO, who is the CEO. Is the company very professional, or is all the family members sitting on the board of that? So I see normally this type of things. So that's all for this video. Thank you, and I hope that you have learned a lot about this. And also I will share in my next video my portfolio, which normally covers all these 15 points mostly, most of the cases. Thank you.